somehow. Something your kiss just told me, my sometime is now. Everybody finds somebody someplace. There's no telling where love may appear. Something my heart keeps saying, my someplace is here.
Hello from Michael Friedland. And the question to be asked in tonight's episode of Dino, the Dean Martin Story, is the one that ran through the star's mind when he split up with the comedian Jerry Lewis in 1956. Could either of them manage without the other? Jerry told us last week that it was his idea to call it all off.
The saddest thing, I guess, for us was it was necessary for the team to break up. And when we did, we had contracts totaling $235 million that would go into the dumper if we didn't stay as a team. That didn't mean anything to either one of us.
Call now Arthur Marx, the Martin and Lewis biographer, who incidentally is a son of Groucho.
You know, everybody said Jerry was doing great and Dino was going to fall down when they split up, and it turned out to be just the opposite. Jerry went downhill and Dean went uphill. And then Dean had his big TV show for quite a while. They don't have any shows like that anymore because there are no performers around anymore. It's terrible now. I'd need some Dean Martins and Frank Sinatras and Sammy Davises, even Jerry Lewis.
But there were signs that Dean was the stronger one of the partnership. This is the comedian, Shecky Green.
Well, I happened to be on the set of a picture called Partners that they did. And Dean come running up after one shot, and I heard him get on the telephone screaming and yelling, and this dirty Balago Bajandago, calling him a Jew and calling him this, and he didn't know what to say to him, to whoever he was talking to. He said, "That's it, I can't do it anymore."
Hear that lonesome whippoorwill, he sounds too blue to fly. The midnight train is whining low. I'm so lonesome I could cry. I've never seen a night so long when time goes crawling by. The moon just went behind a cloud to hide his face and cry.
But by most accounts, it was Jerry who was crying. And he still is.
We hurt each other by allowing the split to happen. Even though we psychologically, intellectually, and every other way assumed we're doing the right thing for us, we hated that decision. And we would have liked to have been knocked through the ropes. We would have liked to have been taken from that high tower and knocked into the toilet. But at least we'd have been together. Which isn't realistic.
Jerry Lewis. He told our Hollywood correspondent Barbara Paskin that the public were pretty upset about it all.
We received like 300,000 letters the first month. Angry. What right do you have to do this? Every Sunday we would go and see you, which wasn't the case. And how do we go on? And what right do you... And we were theirs. We had no right without checking with them. We understood it and was beautiful.
And Dino had now to think about a new career. This is Jeannie, the woman he married, divorced, and then went back to until his dying day, without ever marrying her again.
He could hold his own if he'd been just out there as a comedian. He could have held his own just as a singer. He could have held his own if he just did films or just recorded songs.
Certainly it was Dean Martin, the singer, who seemed to offer most promise. He'd been making records since 1946, none of them very important, but in the days when women went into Woolworths and paid a shilling or two for cheap versions of their favourite tunes, Dean Martin could usually oblige.
I got no diamonds, though I'm shy, still I think I'm a lucky guy. I got the sun in the morning and the moon at night. Got no mansion, got no yard, still I'm happy with what I've got. I got the sun in the morning and the moon at night. Sunshine gives me a lovely day. Moonlight gives me the Milky Way. Got no checkbooks, got no bank. Still I'd like to express my thanks. I got the sun in the morning and the moon at night. And with the sun in the morning and the moon in the evening, I'm all right.
At that time, back in 1946, there wasn't much else that Dino did have. But once he teamed with Jerry Lewis, they rushed to superstar status. And one of the first things to happen to them was a contract from Capitol Records. Call now Alan Livingston, artist and repertoire manager of their famous label, the one with its Capitol Dome, right above the hole.
It was early in my career at Capitol, and Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis were very big, had exploded on the nightclub circuit, and we decided to sign them. We didn't know what we were going to do with them or who we were going to record, but we just latched on to a very successful team.
Alan Livingston, who would become chairman of Capitol. It was soon proved to be a pretty good deal for both parties. Jerry wouldn't actually do much more than support Dean on a handful of sides, like the ubiquitous Partners and Every Street is a Boulevard in Old New York, which we heard last week. But for Dino, it was a serious career move. That's Amore was an early million seller and came from the film The Caddy. And there were to be dozens of other huge hits, like this one.
How do you speak to an angel? I'm completely in the dark. When you know that you've just met an angel, is there a proper remark? We were alone for a moment. Why was I lost in a cloud? Do you speak to an angel in a whisper, or do you just say I love you out loud?
Could he better that sort of output with no comedy partner to bring in the really big dollar? But back in 1956, it was more than just an academic question, especially since Mr. Martin wasn't exactly renowned for most people's ideas of hard work.
No rehearsals. At the time of the session, we'd go through it once or twice. And that was it. The sessions were very easy. Dean didn't much care. He was never critical of the orchestration. He just went along, and with whatever songs we came up with and whatever arrangements the orchestra made, he accepted it. And then he was glad to get out of the session.
Everyone knew that Dino liked to sing. His wives could have told you that. He and his first wife, Elizabeth, or Betty as she was better known, were married in 1941, and she gave him four children, Craig, Gail, Claudia, and Dina. But she had a drink problem, and the two were divorced. And then Dino met Jeannie Bigger.
It was the Orange Bowl Queen, And that was the college thing. And with the float, you know, the parade and all the things that go with that. And he just followed the float. He was walking, and I guess the parade was there, and he just, you know, he saw, well, where's the queen, you know, go take a look at her. I remember looking down and seeing him, and I remember he had on a striped T-shirt and an armful of Christmas boxes, you know, and he was just walking there looking at me. He and Jerry were appearing there at a hotel in Miami Beach, so he invited me there, and so that's how we met. And, of course, my friends were, you know, thought it was just the worst thing in the world.
It was the beginning of an up-and-down romance that would end distinctly on an up. They married and stayed that way for 23 years. And Jeannie adopted Dino's four children and then had another three herself. Dean Paul, whom everyone knew as Dino Jr., Ricky and Gina, all living in the same house. Gail, as we heard before, was one of Betty's children.
Oh, they were a wonderful couple. And they were a wonderful couple after they divorced, and he married someone else, and then he came back and saw us. So they were a lovely couple. And she's dear. We see her all the time. He had the best time, I think, when he was with all of us at home.
Well, a lot more about that as our story unfolds. But back to the music. His favourites? Undoubtedly those of the country and western variety.
If I see you tomorrow on some street in town, pardon me if I don't say hello.
Hello.
I belong to another. It wouldn't look so good to know someone I'm not supposed to know. Just walk on by, wait on the corner. I love you, but we're strangers when we meet. Just walk on by, wait on. I love you, but we're strangers when we meet.
Like so many others of his generation, Mr. Sinatra for one, he said his ambition was to sing like Bing Crosby, as the journalist James Bacon remembered.
He once told me, he says, Bing Crosby had his tonsils taken out and I bought them.
And Jerry Lewis had his own ideas about that.
He made Bing Crosby sound like the Wicked Witch of the West. He was so relaxed and so cool, and his vocalizing was so unencumbered.
Certainly he did his best. After all, in one of the Martin and Lewis early movies, he sat in the corner of a room, pipe in mouth, singing like Bing Crosby. No, he made no secret of it.
Ba-ba-ba-boo, ba-ba-ba-boo. If I could sing like Bing, how happy I would be. Ba-ba-ba-boo, ba-ba-ba-boo. If I could sing like Bing, perhaps you'd go for me. Ba-ba-ba-boo, ba-ba-ba-boo. Now everyone agrees that Bing is fun to hear. And if I don't do quite as well, just make believe he's near. If I could sing like Bing, forevermore you'd hear. Ba-ba-ba-boo, ba-ba-ba-boo, ba-ba-ba-boo.
Strangely, he seems to have been influenced by a great many of the really important singers of his day, and those of days before, like Maurice Chevalier.
Every little breeze seems to whisper Louise. Birds in the trees seem to twitter Louise. Each little rose tells me it knows I love you. Love you. Every little beat that I feel in my heart seems to repeat what I felt at the start. Each little sign tells me that I adore you, Louise.
Martin singing Chevalier. He also did Jolson, Carolina in the Morning, Tut Tut Tootsie, Swanee, Is It True What They Say About Dixie, I'm Sitting on Top of the World, which he was. And then there was this.
The stars
twinkle and shine this evening about a quarter to nine. My loving arms are gonna tenderly twine, sweet, sweet twine around you around a quarter to nine.
But no one could have believed just how successful he'd be. Love, of course, came into it. Often, as Jeannie said in our first program, he had his silly midlife crisis.
You're nobody till somebody loves you. You're nobody till somebody cares. You may be the king, you may possess the world and its gold. Ah, the gold won't bring you happiness when you're growing real old. The world still is the same, you'll never change it. As sure as the stars shine above. Oh, you're nobody to somebody really loves you. So find yourself somebody to love.
You're nobody till somebody loves you, which Dino himself knew was an absolute fact. But then he met and fell in love with a much younger Kathy Horn. And they were married for 4 years. But Jeannie was waiting for him when he was finished, although they never married again. And there were any number of women who were involved in that midlife crisis. Angie Dickinson says she went out with him.
Over the years, we grew to be very warm friends. His wife gave Christmas parties, and even after they divorced, Dean was... It was as if they were never divorced.
Angie Dickinson co-starred with Dino in two movies. Of course, a lot of his hits did come from his pictures, and not all of those movies were very much to write home about, it has to be said. Certainly not his first solo venture, which was called 10,000 Bedrooms, a title which may have seemed appropriate to those who knew something about Dino's nocturnal habits at that time.
If you're a special kind of dreamer with a dreamer's point of view, you need 10,000 bedrooms at least to do all the dreaming you've got to do. And if you want a special rainbow splashing across your skies of blue, you need 10,000 bedrooms at least. And just watch those rainbows come into view.
It could be said that he was now getting into some pretty undesirable company. There's evidence to show that he knew some gentlemen of the long overcoats and twisted noses persuasion. In other words, the mob. Jerry Lewis.
I was playing the 500 Club in Atlantic City. A singer on the show got sick. The gangster that owned the nightclub said, "Jerry, got any ideas? This guy's sick. We got to fill up, you know, the show." He said, "And I don't think I want a singer. I said, well, wait a minute. Dean Martin is my friend, and he's not working right now. He said, I just told you I don't want a singer. I said, wait a minute. He's not just a singer. He does his act, and then he and I do some funny things together. Well, he bid on that instantly. Said, we'll get him. He comes in the next night. He does his act. He does three songs and leaves. I do my act. I leave. And now the gangster meets us in the dressing room and says, we have to have a talk. Dean doesn't know anything about it. And he hears him say to me, if you don't do what you said you're going to do in the next show, you'll be wearing cement boots.
Now I have a story to tell you. At about the time that I was working on my own Dino biography, I spent a lot of time with one of those Hollywood producers who knew everything about everyone. And believe me, if everybody loves somebody sometime in the movie capital, everybody knows somebody who knows everybody. Sometime. Dick Quine was a senior Columbia Pictures producer at about the time that Frank Sinatra famously made his triumphant re-entry into superstardom in a movie called From Here to Eternity.
We'll live from here to eternity.
Was it true, I asked the aforesaid Mr. Quine, that Sinatra got his role in the picture thanks to the mafia, you know, as suggested in The Godfather? No, he said, but the mob did try to put pressure on Columbia on behalf of a certain other Italian-American singer. The only trouble was that Harry Cohn, boss of Columbia, had his own strong men and made them an offer that even they couldn't refuse. So Dee Martin had to wait a little while. Until, that is, a film came along without a single song for him to sing in it, called The Young Lions, which, like From Here to Eternity, was the story of a soldier with problems. He proved in that he could act. But actually he was never happier than when acting in westerns, like one called Rio Bravo.
So I wonder, as I wander, will love come along? Must I live ever haunted by the memory of a song, while the river Rio Bravo
Rio Bravo co-star John Wayne and Angie Dickinson.
Dean called me Feathers for 40 years. That was my name in Rio Bravo. And whenever I would see him, he's, hi, Feathers. Always called me Feathers. He was so like whipped cream. Just delicious and beautiful and soft and gentle.
Yes, but what about the film? It was a
wonderful Western, which we knew it was going to be wonderful, just we didn't know how wonderful, with a great director, great maker of movies. And Dean was also rather green at that time because he was coming off his stand-up. He was in a new arena, as I was. And with the great Howard Hawks, you want to be good.
And he became good in musicals, too. You could say, just in time.
Just in time, I found you just in time. Before you came, my time was running low. I was lost, the losing dice were tossed, my bridges all were crossed, nowhere to go.
Just in time from the film Dino made with Judy Holliday in 1958. bells are ringing. And then in 1962, he signed to make a movie with Marilyn Monroe. Filming began on what was to be called Something's Got to Give. But it was Marilyn who was to give. All too little, as it turned out. She was causing problems and was fired, so Dino bowed out too. I signed to play opposite Marilyn and no one else, he declared. And soon afterwards, Marilyn died, and Dino was sued. The picture was eventually made under the title Move Over Darling with Doris Day and James Garner. But Dino had other interests, especially one called the Rat Pack, involving his pal, Francis Albert Sinatra. But that's for next week. You could say he joined them just in time, too.
Now you're here. Now I know just where I'm going. No more doubt or fear. I found my way. For love came just in time. You found me just in time. And changed my lonely life. That lucky day.
Dino, the Dean Martin story, is written by me, Michael Friedland. It's a Robin Quinn production for BBC Radio 2, and Barbara Peskin is our Hollywood correspondent.